this message. Philippians chapter 4, verse 12. Let's all read together. I know both how to be abased, and I know how to abound. Everywhere and in all things, I am instructed both to be full and to be hungry, both to abound and to suffer need. All right? Notice the first part of verse 12 again. It says, I know both how to be abased, and I know how to abound. I know how to abound. All right? Let's turn to Deuteronomy chapter 8. Deuteronomy. And we're going to read from verse number 1. All the commandments which I command thee this day shall you observe to do, that ye may live and multiply, and go in and possess the land. How many want to live and multiply? I see you living, I see you multiplying, I receive it in Jesus' name. Verse 2. And thou shalt remember all the way, shall we all read together, and thou shalt remember all the way which the Lord thy God led thee these 40 years in the wilderness, to humble thee and to prove thee, to know what was in thy heart, whether thou wouldest keep his commandments or no. And he humbled thee, and suffered thee to hunger, and fed thee with manna, which thou knewest not, neither did thy fathers know, that he might make thee know that man doth not live by bread only, but by every word that proceedeth out of the mouth of the Lord doth man live. Upon thee neither did thy foot swell these 40 years. Thou shalt also consider in thine heart that as a man chasteneth his son, so the Lord thy God chasteneth thee. Therefore thou shalt keep the commandments of the Lord thy God, to walk in his ways and to fear him. Let us pray. Father, we are indeed grateful for this opportunity to receive your word once again. Lord, we are lost without you. Without you, we are blind. We are sick. We are dead. We are useless. But when we find you, we have life. When we have you, Lord, we have hope. We have vision. We have something to look up to. We thank you, Lord. And we pray today in the name of Jesus that, Lord, you will pour out your great blessing of revelation to us, that we may grow in your word and grow in you. In Jesus' name, amen.
Amen.
You may be seated. Thank you. Abundance. Tell somebody abundance is coming.
Abundance.
My subject is the coming abundance.
Preach.
The coming abundance.
Preach.
Very soon, a new type of abundance which you haven't known up to now will strike you.
Amen.
Are you ready to be struck by abundance? Are you ready to be ministered to by the abundance of the Lord? Now, the Egyptians or the Israelites in their time were very similar to us. They experienced hardships, difficulties, and they experienced, you know, great torment under Pharaoh. Now, after some time, God said, you know, I've seen your suffering, and I'm going to take you out of this difficult situation, and I'm going to put you in a place of abundance, a place where the land flows with milk and honey. Milk and honey, you know, the words milk and honey have been used to describe the blessing of the Lord and the abundance of the Lord that he has made for us. Milk and honey. You know, milk makes you fat, and honey is sweet. So things that make you fat and make life sweet.
Yes.
I see sweetness coming your way.
Yes.
Hallelujah.
Amen.
So God is going to bless us, and he's going to take us to the next place. And it's very important that you prepare for that abundance. Because when this abundance strikes, you can easily be destroyed because of the abundance. It's easier to be a Christian in poverty than to be a Christian in abundance. Far easier. That is why black people are generally more spiritual
rich
and more church-going than white people.
Yes.
Because black people are generally poorer and generally have more difficulties. And we have more abasement. We are despised. were despised by America. You know, America wouldn't drop its soldiers into Liberia to help, and they would drop their soldiers to Iraq. Allow every day when you listen to the news, you see one soldier has been killed, two soldiers have been killed, three soldiers have been killed. They don't mind. That they don't mind. For Iraq. But not for Liberia. Not for Sierra Leone. Not for Rwanda. No, no, no. When they were in Somalia, there was a problem. They pulled out. They said, no, no, no. Too many people have died. 10 people or 8 people. Now, come on. But for Iraq. Even when you go home to the put on the news, you tap another American soldier. You know? So we are despised. And when you are despised, you tend to look to God. And we sing songs like, Thou, O Lord, are the sheep about me. You're my glory, you are my glory. And the lifter of my head.
When you come there, what do you
So ladies and gentlemen, let us decide to learn. Let's learn how to abound. You see, God has blessed me. There was a time I'm preaching in the classroom across the road. There's a time I didn't have met many people in my church. There's a time I didn't have even a branch. There's a time when I finished preaching, I don't know when they're going to start us from the canteen. There was a time when my car, my Renault 4, ARD 5664, that was a time, was the only car in the church. There was a time when I used to lay hands on the cobblestones of the streets and pray, Lord, send a car and people who own cars to this church. I used to walk on the road and confess, I see 10 cars. Now I don't know who has a car. People drive by, they ask whether we are selling cars here. There was a time I didn't have a house. I lived in a room, my father's house. He had many rooms, and I lived in room 14. Ify, you visited me in room 14, is that not so? You lived there. So you know what I'm talking about. Today I have a house. So how to serve God when you don't have? And then how to serve Him when you have? There's a time you didn't have money to do your hair. Now you have money to do any style. To change the color, to change the style, to become young, to become old, to become different thing. There was a time you didn't have money to do your nails. But you used to bite your nails. The thing you used to do with your nails was biting, not painting. Biting your nails.
Break!
That's what you're doing. And now, the Lord has blessed you. Look at those nails. Red. Manicure. The tomatoes and grind the shito and whatever. Can these red colored nails still be humble and do what a humble person does and wash and do whatever you have to do? Scrub. It's good preaching. You didn't have a car. When you didn't have a car, your favorite song was Thou, O Lord, our sheep. You're my glory and the lifter of my head. But now you have a car. Your favorite music is. It's a wonderful thing. So the Lord is saying, there are four things today that I want to give you that you must. Number one, remember your difficulties. Remember your difficulties. He says in verse 2, he says, and thou shalt remember all the way which the Lord thy God brought thee. You know, we seem to forget our humble beginnings. And that is something we should never forget. You know, because I tell you, the way God is going to change your circumstances is so drastic that you need to be conscious, you need to remember, you need to remind yourself of the origins. You know, I remember one time I was in Geneva, and I was looking at some of our church members and some of the people that were so, you know, they looked so elitist and so, you know, one guy I remember I was preaching and he was irritated because I said, lift up your hands and let's worship the Lord. Lift up hands and God, he said, Thou Lord. And I said, okay, now put out your hand. Okay, sit down everybody. Then like stand up. You know, I've done it today already. Stand up, let's read the scripture. Okay, sit down. Okay, lift your hands. And then sometimes when we are seeing the Lord, husband and said, lift your hand and so on. So he got a boy and he said, you know, what is this? Are we in kindergarten?
Yeah.
Hey, stand up, sit down, stand up, sit down, put up your hand, put up your hand.
Mercy.
I remember one particular day he was standing there, and as I was singing of Peter, I said, lift up your hand, he wouldn't lift up his hand. So, you know, as time went on, I began to know some of the houses and the homes that some of these people came from in Ghana. I remember visiting a couple of them and I said, ah, is this the house that you came from before you went to Geneva? My mind had gone totally by. I don't know this drug for me. I don't know where it is. showed me. I was going to get a distinction for a credit or whatever. But I just couldn't, I don't remember anything. Why students fail? Because his mind has gone blind. Have mercy. And they could see my paper. I knew the thing. It's only that the tension. Your hand will be shaking, your mouth will be stammering. Why student fail? Tell somebody, student don't fail. Rebuking some, talking about some sister who had gone to fornicate. How? Look at her. She's doing this and that. And Pastor was listening to her and said, hey, because this girl, she was a serial killer before. Experienced veteran, she has slept with series of people. She was a serial killer. As the nearest sister, are you a serial killer in the church?
Mercy.
Mercy. She was a serial killer. So if you have been a serial killer before, thou shalt remember, see how the Lord has told you that now is about 2 years since you last fornicated. Don't just get up and start rebuking, pray for mercy and also forgiveness, because it's by His grace. By His mercy. That you are maybe even married today or whatever. We forget, that's why we start to talk rubbish. Number two, you shall remember all the things that God allowed. He says, and for He suffered thee to hunger, God allows certain things. Hey, don't think that serving God is going to be just roses and beautiful flowers. There's going to be some suffering. He said, He suffered or allowed thee to hunger. You are going to be hungry sometimes when you serve the Lord. When Jesus was led by the Spirit, He was not led by, and the Lord was led by the Spirit to Regal Chinese restaurant. He was led to the wilderness. He said He was led by the Spirit to Papaya. No, most of us are being led to Papaya by our own mind. But He was led by the Spirit to the wilderness. Where there were locusts and there was nothing to eat and nothing to drink. That's where He was led. So sometimes we get to a place and we say, did God bring me here? God can bring me to a wilderness in your life. The Israelites were led into a wilderness by the Lord. He said, you shall remember where thou the Lord has taken through you all these years, 40 years, how He has suffered thee to hunger. Some of the things we've been through, we think God is not the one doing it or the devil, but it's God who is allowing you to go through. He said, to prove thee, to humble thee, to know thee, whether thou would serve the Lord or not. And the first water that He took them to was bitter water called Marah. They named the place Marah, which means bitter waters. Huh? Why would God allow you to come to a bitter experience? Because sometimes, without these bitterness, without these thorns in the flesh, without these things that we pray for that don't go, when we pray, we will be too proud. He said, let I be exalted above measure. We are naturally prone to become like Satan. Our natural tendency is to become satanic and proud. Satanic nature is pride. And we are prone to become proud. It's natural, almost automatically, human beings become proud. And it's pride that led to the first fall and has led to every fall since then. Every fall is caused by pride. I was talking to a pastor who said, I have dealt with 1,500 pastors who fell. And he said, in every single case, there was always the element of pride. Not other things that you may think, but pride is the common factor, the common denominator in every fall. God sometimes brings us to bitter waters. Number three, you must remember the lessons that you learned. Because you see, in the hard times, God will allow you to learn certain lessons. He says, for that, and He taught thee that man does not live by bread alone. When you were in the wilderness, you learned that man does not live by bread alone. How many realize that when you went through certain things, there were certain things that you learned? Certain lessons that you learned, certain things that came to be a part of you. When I was in school, I learned how to have my quiet time. I was taught. student, as a form three or form four young man. You get it? That's why I learned and I have kept those lessons. You shall remember the lessons. Cast your mind and see the lessons God has taught us. Why do we seem to quickly go away from the lessons that He has taught us? Sometimes you see people, they say, Lord, I'll serve you. Lord, I'll do this. Lord, and as soon as the thing goes, you see, in those days, we were not mature. That's why we said certain things. And now we are more mature. So we don't give all our money to the church. Give our money to, you know, school, this, that. We are now more mature. You are not more mature, you are more proud. That's what you are. That's all. That's pride. Pride. You shall remember the lessons. And when you remember the lessons that the Lord has taught you, you will be ready. Because abundance will not be your killer, but abundance will be a true blessing. Then the next one is you remember the miracles which the Lord brought you. He says, thou, thy raiment waxed not old, and thy foot did not swell this 40 years. When you think of a foot swelling, we usually think of, you know, somebody somewhere who is having some problem. You know, but I've seen swollen feet before. I remember one sister, one leg got swollen, elephantiasis. And her lymph vessels were blocked. And I didn't know anything that could remove it. Then they carried it. In fact, the leg had become black, like big fat. You see the legs moving like that. You haven't seen something before. He said, thy foot did not swell. I remember one day in the emergency room, I met a man. He said, my knee began to swell. And I saw his tears. He could not even wear trousers because all these places had become big. He had cancer of the knee. He was dying. And he said, and they told him, we have to amputate the leg. He said, no, never. So he ran away from the hospital and he went to the herbalist. And I remember somehow I came back, I was doing some other rotation or something else, and I came and met this same man who had come back and they had cut off his leg and the thing has come back again. And I began to understand that scripture said that, and thy foot did not swell. Mercy. I said, mercy forever and ever. You see, there are many little things we don't see as miracles. A person who forgets easily is a person who becomes ungrateful easily. And a person who is ungrateful is a person who is nigh to be cursed. Prepare for your curses in your ingratitude. When God blesses you and God does little things for you and you lift your arm up and you say, hey, it would have been better with the cucumbers in Egypt. We should have rather died over there. They expose themselves and posture themselves to be cursed. No wonder it was only 2 people out of 1 million or 4 million of them who left. It was only 2 human beings who walked through and entered the promised land. Because when you are grateful to God that your foot did not swell, your raiment did not get, your raiment did not get old, and so many little things, you are still alive. When you press your breath, there's no cancer in it. You have lived to celebrate certain birthdays, and God has blessed you. There was a time maybe you couldn't even give 5,000 of it. Now you can give 5,000 without thinking about it. You couldn't even buy Milo. Now you can buy Milo. You couldn't have certain things. Now the Lord has blessed you, but these are nothing to you. It's nothing to you. That is why you will experience a curse in your life. You see Judas Iscariot, if he had remembered, if he had remembered the little things that Jesus did, if he had remembered when Jesus was walking on the water, perhaps he would have been a bit slow to go and betray this man. If he had remembered when he saw him, you know, feeding 5,000 people with 5 loaves and 2 fishes, he would have perhaps been cool and said, you know, this man is not an ordinary man. If he had remembered when he was rebuking the storm and the storm calmed, he would have cooled off and said, you know, this is not an ordinary man. If you have remembered when he went to raise Lazarus from the dead after 4 days, a stinking dead body, which was brought up. You know, yesterday I saw a man who had caught a Bela. You know Bela?
Yes.
Bela. He caught it in the morning. So I saw him holding it. And it had become fatter and stiff. So he was holding it. I said, what are you going to do? He was holding it. I said, well, I'm going to eat it. Since morning, you see, when the body is dead from morning to evening, it begins to bloat and it begins to be stiff and big. And this man had been dead for 4 days. And Jesus came along and said, remove the stone. And he said, Lazarus, come forth. Shortly before he died, that was in John chapter 11. He died a few verses later. Just a few chapters, he was born.
Right.
If you remember when Jesus saw a funeral and he was moved with compassion and he saw the woman and he said, oh, I can't take it. Call the woman, call the man. Bring the coffin. Go. Open it. He says, go to them. Hey, come on. Come on.
Hallelujah.
Let's go. Go. It's okay. Don't die.
Hey.
If you have remembered all these little things that Jesus did, when he opened the eyes of the blind, he would not want to betray the Son of the living God. Jesus said it would have been better that he was not born. Perhaps it would have been better that you were not born and you become ungrateful and forgetful how you were, how you were, and the Lord has blessed you and saved you. It's a time for remembrance. To remember. Ask God blesses you. One day some of you will be in America.
Yes.
I promise I know. There are more than 20 people here who will be in America soon.
Yes.
It's a friend of mine there. Remember how you used to sit in Kolekono and you used to lift your hand and say, ash. You lift your hand and you say, amen. You used to lift your hand and shout, mercy. You used to lift your hand and say, mercy. And you used to lift your hand and say, forgive. And remember. Remember. How you used to wear second hand, everything second hand. How you used to come to church, amen, mercy, flow, and then you go to America, and then you say, okay, say that, and then with some kind of laughter, is it locally applying for it? That's right. Hey, glory to God, Pastor, you know. Yeah, all right. You know, some of us, we have been doing certain jobs, and so, Pastor, you know, sometimes we don't get a time to come around, and so, you know, we will not be able to be around, and so, Pastor, so, hey, Charlie, how is Accra anyway? Make it to church after, but you know, we pray for us so that we get some small prosperity, you know, Pastor. God bless you. Mouth like God bless you. And you've forgotten your God. You used to shout, bless you, Lord. Forgive that. You are speaking slang and you are saying you can't come to church because of your job. He said, Pastor, as you went on Sundays and here things are different. Here we work. But I see abundance is working. I see abundance is working. start speaking normally in the first place. That's your first thing. From next to speaking to normal speaking. Just calm down. Hey, our time is up. Let's go home. Stand up. How many are going to remember God in your day of abundance? Lift your hand and thank God for abundance in your life.
Thank you. you may be seated in the presence of the Lord.